What's up, everybody? In this talk, we're going to be talking about how to convert Vim into an IDE for whatever language you want in a way that supports an integrated navigational environment that's just as good as an IDE. Now, of course, Vim cannot fully replace any IDE, especially in cases where you have fat Java projects with Gradle or Maven, but for many cases, like small Go or Python microservices, it works just fine. And I actually just gave this talk at the virtual Vim conference, but unfortunately, I wasn't able to get the key casting working and it was a bit choppy, so I wanted to redo this so that you can fully embrace what I want to teach you in a way that's really easy to follow along and that's concise and clear. And another reason I'm doing this is because I also went all in crypto a few months ago and my net worth just went to zero because crypto got screwed over. And so I have no money and I want to try to just become a poor YouTuber instead. So let's get started. Vim, 7 steps for setting up Vim as a lightweight IDE. And side note, please check out the Vim conference talks. They're all going to be uploaded. And although mine is going to be replayed in this format, all these other speakers have done phenomenal jobs. So please check them out at vimconf.live. And yeah, that's about it. Let's get started. So 7 steps I recommend. The first step is creating a minimal vimrc. And for anyone who's a bit impatient or who hasn't looked at the description for what's about to come, we're going to be talking about creating your vimrc, using include search, which is the crux of this talk, super powerful feature, the most powerful feature, as well as setting your path, setting up compilers to work, setting up formatting. We're going to go over a lot. So just bear with me because it gets better with every step. So the first step is the simple one most people are quite familiar with, which is making a minimal vimrc. And before doing this, let me show you what I have. What I have in stock for y'all is this vim demo folder. And if I run a tree on this, and I ignore the stupid PYC files because I have some Python here, I have 2 repos. I have one for Go, and I have one for Python. And what these 2 application packages are doing is they're creating a way of converting between feet and meters. But the contents of the application matter less. What matters here is my approach to integrating Vim for a language of your choice with Go and Python as examples. And to show you that I'm legit, I'm going to delete all of my user Vim configurations. And I'm also going to delete the vimrc file I have. And this is just showing that I will teach you this from scratch. This is 0 to 100. And you're going to learn all of it just as long as you bear with me. So we're really starting with a bare minimum right here. And let me just start by opening one of these files. Let's say the demo file in the metric/command module. And I also want to run this in no compatible mode, meaning I don't want to run with the original VI settings, but I want Vim improved. So I want the Vim settings. And usually if you have a vimrc, this is automatically defined for you. And the next thing I want to do is I want to run this without any configuration settings at all from a normal vimrc. And you might say, well, wait, you just deleted your vimrc configurations. I did, except there's one caveat, which is Vim has a predefined defaults vimrc configuration that gets loaded if one isn't set. So by doing this, I'm making sure that that's not actually executed as well. So when we open this, the first thing you want to say is my eyes hurt so much. This is black and white. I'm not living in the 1960s or 70s. And I really want to pull my hair out. And you know what? I could not be a programmer back in the day when there wasn't color on the screens. I have no idea how they were able to code all this. That blows my mind. But anyway, from this, let's figure out some set of default X commands we would want for a vimrc. I'm talking no more than, 5 or 6 different X commands. The first one I'd recommend is figuring out how to detect the file type. So if you run a set file type, you'll notice that the file type is not actually assigned. And this is because we haven't enabled file type detection. So one thing we want to do is enable file type detection, as well as plugin detection, meaning we can infer from a Go file what its relevant X command settings to run are, as well as any relevant indentation configuration options. We turn that all on. And now, if I manually detect my file, which you can also do just by reloading or reopening this file, you'll see that it's in fact set to Python. And another thing we want to do is not make our eyes hurt so much anymore and turn on syntax highlighting, which is probably the most important configuration setting you'll ever want. Now, once this is done, there's only a few other things I'd suggest. One, when I first started Vim and I was trying to start from nothing, this screwed me up a lot. My backspace didn't work. And I was freaking out. I'm like, what the hell is going on? Vim couldn't possibly be this complicated that I have to really edit everything completely on the command line. Like, what's going on? And then I typed a few, and then I was like, oh, I can type and hit backspace, but not prior to the start of my insertion. And so what's happening here is by default, there's a backspace option that you have to add because it doesn't include the start of your insert operation. So you have to add to include deleting starts, end of lines, and indents. And now we can actually delete everything. So one more thing I would add is, let's say you want to open up a new file, right? And let's say we want to open up a directory. And I just realized I want to quickly make a directory called home/.vim because we're going to want one. And let's say I want to open that up. It's going to say no write since last change. And the reason for this is by default, Vim will not allow you to switch buffers unless that buffer was fully written and then unloaded. And the way to get around this is the set hidden option, which says instead of having to completely write that file to disk, you can make it remain hidden. And this is good if you want something a lot more convenient. It might not be good if you're super OCD of accidentally quitting out of all your files and losing all these unsaved changes. That's kind of where swap files come into play sometimes, I believe. But for me, I hate this setting. I absolutely hate it. So now, if I open that directory up, I can do so without having to save. And what I want to do now is figure out where to put my vimrc setting. Because what we just did was we defined 3 or 4 X commands that work as a nice minimal vimrc. And what I suggest here is to use this third option. So most people are familiar with the home/.vimrc. This is the most commonly used configuration place to put all your vimrc X commands. But this third option is much more portable because it combines your user runtime files with your user vimrc file. And another thing worthy of mentioning is this first found vimrc option. You can actually specify all your vimrc configuration settings in an environment variable. So this is really useful if you're debugging or creating some ad hoc script on some machine that's remote and not local to your integrated environment that you might only use 1 or 2 times. Well, you can quickly port all your settings without having to create a new file by defining them in this environment variable. So anyway, we want to put it right here. So all I have to do is create a file called vimrc. And right now I'm using the netrw directory listing plugin, which is built into Vim. So I'm going to create a file called vimrc, and I'm just going to add those settings. So one of them was file type plugin indent on, right? And another thing we wanted was to get syntax highlighting on. And finally, we want to set the backspace to include the ability to delete the indentation, end of line, and start kind of, you know, positions. And then finally, we like the set hidden option because that helps a lot. And what we can do is we can source this so that we've sourced our vimrc. And right before I get to the second step, I'd also advocate for defining a few environment variables to make navigation easier. For example, one thing I like to do is I like to have one for my runtime path, specifically my user runtime path. If you do a set RTP with a question mark, you can see what the runtime path is. And this is the source of all the Vim configuration X commands that get dynamically loaded when you're running Vim. And the first one is almost always the user Vim runtime folder. So I'm setting my RTP environment variable to be just that. Now, the second thing we might want is just the environment variable to get to our RC file, our vimrc file, really quickly. So I like to set this to just home/.vim/vimrc. And that's great. That's a great basis, minimal vimrc. You don't need to add anything else yet. This is a great starting point. So let's go to step two. So step two, what we want to do is we want to figure out how we could get formatting working, because that makes sense as a nice next step. And here you can see that minimal vimrc I just talked about. So when we're talking about formatting, what you'd usually do is you'd look up the standards for whatever language you're working with. For Python, that standard is PEP 8. And what PEP 8 really recommends is 4 spaces per indentation level and limiting lines to a maximum of 79 characters. And just a brief aside, one thing I really like about Go is that you can't be opinionated about your formatting. It forces you to do a single format, but that's great because then everyone can just shut the fuck up and stop debating, right? But anyway, Python standards, 4 spaces per indentation level and a limit of how many maximum characters you want. So let's go back to our file, the Python file. And before I do that, let me just do something really useful. I'm going to set a global file mark on this vimrc file. I could also navigate with my define environment variable, but I'm going to do M capital V to specify I'm setting a global file mark that applies not just within a buffer, hence why it's a capital character I'm using. So this way I can quickly hit the apostrophe capital V to go back here. Okay, so let me go back to my file, which is also the first file in the argument list, because the argument list represents all the different files you have when you initially load Vim. Now when I'm here, what I want to do is this. I want to figure out how to get my formatting started. So one thing we can do is set list to look at all the special characters that are actually being used in this file, character for character. And you'll note that those purported spaces are in fact tab characters. And remember what the PEP recommended for us? It recommended that these are 4 spaces. So let's go ahead and define some formatting options. What I like to do, given those recommendations, are first, we want the indentation level to be 4 spaces. We want tabs to be 4 spaces. We want the tabs to look like they're 4 spaces. And we want the insertion of a tab character to actually expand to 4 spaces, along with auto indentation and smart indentation. And again, you can run a help on any of these to really get into the details of how they play together with one another. I just gave you a very high level overview. So we can add that. And I miswrote something. So when you're in command line mode, you can do Control F to quickly edit all of your command line history, which is really useful. In this case, what was it again? It was the expand. And I want to add that tab at the end, and then I can just hit enter. And we applied those settings. And to actually make these settings reapply on our current file, if we already have these characters that we don't want, we can run retab. And like that, they're turned into spaces. So one last thing. Sometimes people like setting a color column, because like I said, for the PEP 8, they advocate 79 character wide lines. So what we can do is we can make this 80, and now we have a nice boundary to work with. Although the red color is, you know, some people like it, some people don't. I like it because it's really contrast. And it reeks of blood, so you know you don't want to get anywhere close to it. So one last thing, I just want to turn off this list option. And that's it. That's our formatting options. So again, the issue now is, where do we put it? Always, as a beginner, I'm like, where do I put it? Okay, I have these configuration settings. Where do I put it? And to figure out where to put it, you should understand the runtime path. And my other talk talks about this in a lot more detail, so please check that out. But I'm going to cover it really briefly here. Basically, the runtime path is where all these runtime files are looked for. And you can imagine you open up a Go file, and then because you have the file type detection set on, it will figure out that that file type is a Go file, and then it will look into the FT plugin folder and find a file called go.vim to load any Go configuration X commands you might have. And basically when this is happening, there's an ordering applied. First you look at the user home, and then maybe a sysadmin folder, then the system vim runtime, then the sysadmin after folder, and then the user home after folder. We can ignore 2 and 4 because they really apply for organizations where you have a corporate-wide system administrative folder, and then everyone has their own specific user folders. For personal reasons, or I mean for personal environments, you really care for 1, 3, and 5 only. And so 3 is the system Vim runtime. That's how Vim works. All that stuff is in the Vim runtime. The interesting thing is the difference between 1 and 5. So although you have that user home Vim runtime, which seems like the obvious place to put all your settings, what the after means is if you put settings here, in the case that there was already a configuration for whatever it is you're doing, like let's say you have a python.vim configuration file for, you know, Python files, let's say there's already one that's built into the system, which there is, and you don't want to override it, well, I can just say to add on to all those features by putting those settings in the after folder. So let's take a step back here. We just defined a bunch of indentation settings for Python. So what's a good place to put these configuration settings, knowing that there's already a Python default configuration in the system? The after folder is a great place, and because it's a specific setting for the file type Python, the FT plugin is a great folder to put this. And here is just what I laid out to you briefly on the terminal window. So what we want to do is let's go to that runtime path. And I'm just going to hit RTP because I defined that. And I forgot to source my vimrc actually. And that's why this isn't working. So I want to first source that. And then hopefully, yep, I'm back there in the user runtime. So now that we're here, I want to create a directory called after, like I said earlier. And in that directory, let's create another subdirectory called ftplugin, go into it, and then create a file called python.vim. And note that all this directory listing stuff is built into netrw. It's kind of useful to learn, although there are a lot of issues with it. It works pretty well when you're starting out. Now let's create that file. And you can see down here that this is the right directory that I do indeed want. And what I want to do is apply those formatting settings that I talked about earlier. And because I'm very lazy, as most Vim users are, there's an easier way of doing this than retyping everything. I know I already typed this, so it's definitely in my command line history somewhere. So again, I can just hit colon to get into that place, and then search through my command line history in normal mode by typing Control F. And I remember that it had something to do with shift width. And once I get there, copy with YY, Control C, Control C, paste it, and I'm good. And then one other thing is we wanted to add that color column, I remember. So that's it. We finally defined formatting settings for Python. Let's move on to the next step. This is where it gets very important. Please pay attention here. One thing you really want to do is set your path. You want to set your path to something that works well with your current working directory. And setting your path is the best way of making sure that you can find any files that you know you want to find. So let me explain how this works. Basically, Python has this option called path, and path specifies the list of directories that will be searched for when you want to look for something with the find command. And oftentimes this plays well with your current working directory. And as such, I advocate that you make your current working directory your project root. I'd be very interested if someone doesn't do this. Write that in the comments if you don't do that, because that sounds absolutely crazy to me. But please let me know about your workflow if you do. But what you want to do is you want to set your current working directory to the project root. And you want to make your path some sane value that encompasses all relevant files of your project. So actions speak louder than words. Let me expand on what I mean. You see this file? Obviously, we can search for stuff in the file, right? Because we have pattern-based searching that allows us to do this. And by the way, let me just add ink search so you can see as I type like that. That's pretty cool. I mean, let me also get the highlight search going. Or maybe no highlight search going right now. But what we can do is take note of this right here, this conversion Python module. How do I go to that directly? Well, typically, what you could do is you could run the find command and jump to it immediately. Wouldn't it be cool if there was a way in Vim where you think of a file you want to go to and you just say find file and I'm there. It doesn't matter where the current file is. I just want to jump to that file in a snap, just like that. Well, that's where the path comes along. And before doing that, remember I recommended setting your current working directory to the project root? Let's look at what ours is right now. In fact, this project is two levels below that. So I'm going to CD into my actual Python project, which is called metrics. And when I print the working directory, you see it's actually that metrics folder. Now, the next thing I want to do is inspect this path, because clearly this path is not actually finding that conversion.py module. And let's figure out what this means, because this initially confused the shit out of me. Because they have one thing for dot and one thing for empty string, and they very much look the same. And when I'm on the command line, often the dot means the current file. Well, guess what the dot is? It's the current file. So I guess it does make sense. So this means the directory of your current file, which is this file right here. This is another default setting, which is most likely where all the system Vim runtimes are located. And then this empty string means your current working directory. So when I run a find on this string conversion, it's trying to find any file that starts with conversion and checks if it exists in any of these directories. Clearly, it doesn't, because it's not in this current file's directory, nor is it in my working directory. So this is how you start to tailor your path. And typically what I do is I set the path to the current file and the current directory along with all of its children. That is expanding recursively downwards from the project root across all subfolders. So I like this setting. And before you shit on me and say, oh, the double asterisk, you know, it results in all these stupid, bottlenecks for performance. Before you shit on me, let me expand on what you mean there. So the issue people have with the double asterisk for the path option is that it's essentially indexing your entire project. So for big projects, yeah, definitely don't do this. Make it something a bit more specific. For structured languages or languages that have a very structured kind of, you know, format in terms of how the repository is structured, this is a bit easier because, for example, for Java, you can say only look at the source directory and all of its children. But anyway, what I suggest is play around with it. For me, a lot of the times this works, especially in the world of microservices, this is just fine. This works really well for me. So what I want to do right now is I just want to remember how I set that global file mark. I'm just going to jump there really quickly, and I'm going to set my global path to be the current file and all the directories traversed downward from my current working directory. I think that's a really nice global setting to have. And then for my Python settings, I actually typically do the exact same thing. So let me just go to the Python file. I thought I had set a mark for that Python file, but I didn't. So let me go into that runtime path and then go into the after python.vim file. I hate swap files. I forgot to turn that off. So the way you turn that off is set no swap file. You should add that in your vimrc too. Let's add that. I really hate swap files. They're just the bane of evil. So that's probably the last thing I recommend adding here. Set no swap file. That shit's so annoying. So back to the Python configuration, right? Back to the path stuff, okay? So in the path, what you want to do is, at least for me, I like to make this a local option, meaning I want the path only to be applied to my current buffer. And this is important when you're trying to multiplex within Vim using either tabs or windows, because this ensures that this path option only applies to the buffer in which you loaded this Python file. But I like to make it the same thing, the current file and all the working directories below it. And the reason for this is because I typically put my virtual environment, which has all that shit in it, in a separate folder separated from my actual project root. And another thing you might want to do is add this thing called wildignore, because often there are certain files you just don't give a shit about that you don't want to see, and you want to ignore them, like these compiled Python files. So let's just go back and show you that this works. Now if I do a find on conversion, I can go right there. And that's paths and the current working directory. we're moving on. It just keeps getting better and better. So, brief recap, what I personally do, I set a global path option for my vimrc, which applies to all files, and then I set a file type specific one for Python. I think this kind of workflow works really well. Now, this is the juice of everything. This is the part where you figure out why Vim is really so powerful. And this is the part that most people don't actually play around with. And because they don't play around with it, they start shitting on Vim and they'll be like, oh, Vim can't be an IDE. If I want to find a certain symbol, I can't fucking find it. You know, IntelliJ can do this instantly. Vim sucks. Well, fuck you, man. You didn't even try to include search. And let me explain to you why it's so magical. Include search is a very powerful way of searching for any symbol within the file's current context. And that could be between more than one file, not just your current file. So to expand on that, pattern search, which is when you use the slash and try to identify some pattern like this, which doesn't match. So it says pattern not found, and then you find a pattern and it matches and you use N. Whereas this is for searching within your current file, the include-based search is for searching within your file's context, within the project's context with regards to your current file. And the way this works is pretty much, this is a high-level explanation, pretty much all it's doing is it's saying, whatever I'm importing here at the top, these are relevant files that I should also be searching for whatever symbol you want to look up. So an example here, if we just go down, you see this feet, right? You see this feet symbol? Clearly, we want to find where that is, and it's not in this current file because my search is only giving me results right here. But it's clearly in this metrics Python module. So I want to be able to go to that directly, and this is where include search shines. Because what include search does is two things. The first thing is it identifies a pattern called include. And the include pattern is used to identify which files should be traversed for searching relevant symbols. Hence why it's called include search, because I like to think about it as any included files that should be looked for when traversing include search symbols. So how does this work? And does it work right now with our default Python settings? Well, let's check that out. Before doing that, let me kind of give a rundown on how it works. If we look at the include pattern, which I just showed you in the presentation, we can see that for Python, it defaults to this assignment. That is a beginning of line, some amount of white space, and then either a from or an import. And we can search this directly by using the register, which corresponds to include. And as you see my four matches. And so what happens is, whatever is matched, the keyword after that match will be used and attempted to be traversed to find an actual file. And how this works is, if this is not a file already, Python will add something called the suffixes add option, which in Python's case is .py. So it'll try to see if argparse.py is a file. And if that doesn't work, there's another thing called the include expression. And what this is a function that you can put into where whatever is matched, this is a function that you ingest your matched string into such that it'll spit out a potentially linked file path. And obviously, if one can't be found, then one just can't be found. So what's happening here is, ideally, we match this with our include pattern, and then we turn this into a file that can be found relative to our current path, because this is a relative import. At least it might think of it as a relative import. Another reason why current working directory should be project root. So ideally what's happening here is that it turns this dot into a slash and it adds a .py to get to that file. And then because it gets added, we can find the symbols even though we're on a different file. And everything will glue together in 1 second, trust me. So let's see if that works. And to see if that works, we can use any of include search's many different commands. One is the IJ command, which jumps to wherever the symbol may be included. So back to what I was talking about, right? Feet. What we can do is we can do an IJ, which means include search based jump, on that symbol feet. And it worked. We jumped to the first pattern occurrence that was found based off all the imports we've made in our Python file. So how did that happen? Well, I kind of explained how that happened, right? We had the import match, and then whatever that include expression is set to was clearly able to transform this into the relevant path. And we can check this by running check path. That is, we can see all of the imported files that were successfully linked for include search. And we can see that this conf/metrics.py file was in fact found. But hold on a minute. We didn't get the one after that. That was only found to be a string called conf. And this makes sense, actually. If we go to that match, right? I said whatever keyword is after gets matched. This keyword is just a conf string. Whereas our file is this conversion.py file. So now we get to the juice where you want to start taking notes, because I'm going to show you how to tailor your configuration to support this kind of include search configuration. And let me take you through my step-by-step process by how I do this. First, I want to identify a regex that's able to match all of my import statements in a way that I can then transform the match statement into something that becomes a relevant file path. So in my case, I want to transform this and this. So I want to match these two highlighted strings right here, the conf space import space conversion and conf.metrics. By the way, I obviously also want to match this and this, but these two are actually external packages, so we don't really care about them. But of course, we want to match this too to see if it is a local package. Now, how would I do this? Well, in this case, we're just matching the importer they're from, and it's saying whatever follows, the first keyword that follows, we use that to ingest into our include expression. But another way you can do this is to directly tell Vim what regular expression that string should be. And so how I do this is the following. I want to make a regex that matches whatever it is I'm trying to match, which is what I highlighted to you earlier. And so let me just turn on HLS so that we can see this end to end like that. So what I want to do here is I want to first start with an empty line and then some amount of white space, just like they were doing earlier, or the Vim system was doing. And then we match what they match too. But now it gets tricky, because now I want to match basically whatever follows after, but before an end of line or a space as string stream. And so what I can do now is I can say to start this match with ZS. And this is a really fantastic way of matching regular expressions where you want to match something after another thing. So I'm going to use /ZS, and then I'm going to say I want some group consisting of non-white space characters happening one or more times, and then some amount of actual white space characters, but as few as possible. And I want this to happen some amount of times because we might have more than one of these groups, right? And I want this to be right before either an end of line or a space and an as. And when we get this, if we put all this together, one thing I did wrong was I didn't escape this properly. We get exactly that matched regex. So this is awesome. So that's step one. Define a pattern and try to match whatever it is you're trying to match. And then the next thing we want to do is let's jump right back in to our Python plugin file. And again, I forgot I didn't put a mark there, so let's go there into the runtime path we define, right into our Python file. And let me make a mark for this, M capital P, so I can refer back to it later. And I want to put that include expression right into this, and it's saved in my search register, so I can immediately use that by, while in insert mode, hitting Control R equals and then whatever my register is, in case you were wondering. And one other thing we got to do right now is we have to replace all of the pipelines as well as the backslashes with a backslash followed by that matched either backslash or pipeline. So that was a big mouthful. This part doesn't really matter much because all I'm doing is I'm replacing all the backslashes and pipelines with the backslash followed by whatever was matched. And that's just because of how these configuration, you know, symbols are defined. This, in this case, it requires to be escaped. I also had to backslash that space. So that's my include pattern, and it looks like shit. I mean, this, who's gonna try to interpret any of this? This is why people sometimes will, you know, just start using plugins. And I really wish there was more work in this community for defining include search configurations for each languages. Unfortunately, there isn't much, but hopefully this will start to get the ball rolling again with that if enough people are interested. But yeah, I mean, this is a pain in the ass to build at first, but this is the only hard part. After this, everything's a lot easier. And I promise once you do it the first time, it becomes a lot more logical or intuitive, I mean. So once we have our include pattern, the next thing we can do is we can create a function to take these matched patterns, strings, and turn them into file paths that can be linkable. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to define a function called pyinclude. And yeah, let me just quickly go back to that import statement and copy paste this set of import statements, because that's what we're trying to work with right here. And what I want to do now is I want to show you that we have two options essentially that we're working with. We have this import conf.metrics option, in which case we want this to match the conf.metrics portion, and we want that to be transformed into a conf.metrics.py file, right? So let's call this option one. And then let's say that option two is this conf/metrics.py. That's why I did that jump actually. The second option is this big string, and what gets matched here is conv import conversion. And basically, I'm going to make this even more ambitious, because in Python, this isn't necessarily a module. This could be a function. So I want this syntax, the from x import y with optionally an as at the end, I want that syntax to be able to interpret one or more files. I want this to interpret either conv/conversion.py, or if conversion is in fact a function and that isn't a file path, I want it to interpret that as conv.py. And so let's write this out live, all live. So how should we do this? Well, and this is a good way to get started with Vim script too. And if you're interested in Vim script, I think the Vim conference did a session on Vim script that you should definitely check out. But first thing I want to do, let's look at this first option. Changing this into this, it seems pretty simple. You just replace the dot with a slash and you add the .py extension. For this, there's a bit more going on. Specifically, we obviously first want to split by this string. So let's do just that. Let's say that we're splitting our argument by this string space import space. At this point, what we have is two things. That first option will be transformed into an array of length 1 that looks like this, and the second option will be transformed into an array of size 2 with conv and conversion. And then the second thing we want to do is let's figure out how to deal with getting this full path for the second case. Because for the first case, or for the first case of the second option, all we're doing, right, is we take this, replace this with a slash, add a .py. Same for here. with this first part of the array, which is also the first part and only part of this first option, we just do the same thing. So let's figure out how to do that more complicated part. Well, what I can do is I can just say that my left part is, you know, the first part of the array. So for one, right, that's just conf.metrics, and for two, that's just conf. And I'm taking baby steps here to make sure you can all follow along. A lot of people, they'll just speed through, no explanation at all. Hopefully I'm doing you a favor by going this slowly. Or if I'm being an asshole by being so fucking slow, you can 2x that speed. So if the length of the parts is more than one, so that second case, we can first try joining this together and seeing if that's an actual file path. So we can say that the right is the parts one, so that's just conversion. And then we can join this together by saying join L and R with a dot. And so the join thing is now joined conv.conversion, right? And then finally we can say let FP, file path, equal the substitution of this join variable where we replace the dot with a slash, make this replace global, and then append the .py extension. And then finally we can check if we're able to find this path by running glob on it. And if we are, then all we gotta do is return that found matched pattern, or file path, sorry. And that's it. So again, just to reiterate, I'm specifically looking here at the second option. And first I'm trying to join the conv with the conversion and add a .py to see if this is a file path. And if it is, I return it. And that's gonna be the linked include search file that we can actually associate with our current context. Now, if it isn't, we can then just try what we just did on just the first part of the array, which is the only part of the first option. So all I need to do right now is, you know, copy that substitute command. And here's a cool tip. Normally what people do, especially if they're beginner to intermediate, they'll search for it, they'll copy it, they'll jump back with control O, they'll paste it. That works pretty well, but we can do better. We can always do better in Vim. So a thing I really like to do, which has now become a bad habit in that I don't do this enough anymore, is to just run range-based commands. So I look for the pattern and I just say to copy it to my current line. And now I don't have to deal with jumping back and forth, which is awesome. And now I'm just, you know, changing up to that equal sign and returning it. And this joined now becomes a L. And that should be the end of the function. And then finally, we want to define that our include expression is in fact that pyInclude function with that file name as the argument. And that should be it. Now, this is a live demo, so there's a huge, huge chance I made an error somewhere. But as I always do, I'm going to run this live, and because I'm a legend, I'm willing to bet that I might have not fucked up. So to do this, first we have to make sure that Python is detected again, its file type is detected, and then I'm going to run that check path operation to see if that path was in fact included. And of course I fucked up, because it's a goddamn live demo and this shit always happens, but fear not, we're now doing live debugging, so hopefully you'll learn a bit from that. So end function, not inside function. So what that means is the function syntax clearly is screwed up somehow, and I'm just trying to figure out why at this point, because the end function seems like it's correctly wrapped. We have the function and then the pyInclude definition. We have the parts, we're splitting that together, that looks good. We get the left part, we check if the parts length is greater than one, that also looks good. We get that right part, we then look at the joined output. We then combine that with a substitute and append the .py to the end. We run a glob on that. We then check if there's a returned file path from that. We end it with an end if, and then finally we return a substitute. And only after reading this whole goddamn function do I see the issue, which you probably detected a long time ago since you're watching this video and you're skimming it a bit more easily, and that's because I define end function twice. So I almost made it, guys. I believe I'm still a legend. Just one error. Let's see if we get two errors. Unfortunately, we still got another error, and I'm wondering why that's the case. Let me just see what the file type is equal to. Let me see if the include expression is properly set. It definitely is. For some reason, it's not picking up this as an included file, and I'm wondering why that's the case now. So if I look closely, we can actually debug this and see what is being printed out for this file path. So if I do that same thing with the check path, it is in fact printing out conv/conversion.py. So for some reason, it's even though we're joining it correctly, it's not able to find it, which is really weird. I'm wondering if it's a path issue. It doesn't look like it. At this point, everything looks right to me. And we glob it together. And aha, I didn't actually return the damn found path. So I just showed you how you can debug all of this. The catch was this was all planned out. Do you believe me? Let's go back. So now I'm 100% confident this will work, and you can see that the included file was in fact linked. So now what happens is before running an IJ, I'm not sure if I showed you that, by the way, but before running an IJ on this function F2M wouldn't have worked because it wasn't able to find it anywhere else except the current file. But now we can actually go jump there directly. And the other cool thing about include search is there's many ways to use it. For example, if your cursor is already on it, you can do control left brace, control I to open it in a new window, for example. In this case, it didn't work. Why is that? M2F. Oh, it worked. I just typed it wrong. Yeah, you can do something like that to jump to the actual definition directly. Or you can do something like, let's say, Control W, Control I to open it in a separate window. So that was a huge mouthful, but I think it's important and really helpful for learning. Now, the second part is define. So what's the difference here? Well, let's say we want to look at this function called shack right here. What I can do is I can do an ilist or an ij to jump directly there, right? And you can see it brought me to this first place where it sees the word shack. But maybe that's not the first place we want to go to, because this is just a pattern. What if we want a concrete set of macros that we say only this type of macro do we want to go to when looking for a pattern? So whereas the normal include search functions prefixed usually with I incorporate any arbitrary pattern, we can kind of constrain this a bit more to represent discrete macros. So for example, maybe I want to say, when I'm looking something up, I don't want to just look at any occurrence of it. I want to look up functions, constants, or methods that correspond to that pattern and nothing else. And that's where define comes into play, which finds macro definitions using the files that were linked from your include expression, but only identifying those that abide to a specific define pattern. And so we can do that really quickly. If I go back to my Python file, I can create a define pattern. And in interest of time and not going through this anymore, let's just figure out how to do that. So here, all I can say is, I can just say, I want whatever is matched after a white space, some number of times, followed by either the keyword define or class. And I'm gonna wrap this in a word boundary. And I can save that, go back to my first file, and then do the file type detection again so that we load those X commands. And now watch this. If I do a DJ, not an IJ, on shack, it couldn't find the definition. So again, live debugging, I already see the issue here. What we did wrong was I didn't actually properly set this grouping, because it should be something that has backslashes replaced. So remember how I had to do that with the include? We got to do that with the define too. Now if I redo this, the file type detect, and do a DJ on shack, it goes directly to the definition of shack rather than just the occurrence of the pattern where that was first found. And so using these two in tandem can be extremely powerful, because now you can find any symbol as long as you set your current working directory and your path properly so that all interpreted paths are relative to that current working directory, and you set an include and define expression, you pretty much got really nice IDE-like navigation. And so we're finally going to move on from the include search. Again, this is the kind of, this is a really simple example you might use. The one I just showed you is a lot more involved, so maybe you'll want to write that down. And now let me jump to something different. Let me get out of this Python file. Let me just actually create a new tab for that. And I just want to cd into my Go directory this time, which is two levels above. And in my Go directory, you know, I have a bunch of functions. Note that I can immediately jump to my file because I got the path working just like that. And one thing you'll note for Go is that the import syntax is a bit different. And because of this, you might be thinking, wait a minute, how would I use include in this case? Because the problem here is that include search works on a line-by-line basis. If I wanted to find out where this file is, for example, obviously I could use include expression to make sure that we interpret just relative to whatever is after my name, Leeren, from the metrics folder. But even so, the issue here is how the syntax works. It's encompassed in an import statement. So defining a pattern to match all this can be very complicated. So one main point to get out of all of this is that Vim definitely works better for certain languages and less so for other languages for different sets of functionality. For example, a lot of the built-in navigational tooling works great for C and pretty well for Python, for example. But Go being a newer language, it doesn't have as much built-in support. However, there are fallback options that we can use. And in Go's case, an excellent one is working with tags. So whenever include search fails, always try to use tags to do all of your project-based navigation. And tags are so simple. All you have to do is run C tags on your directory, your project root, and that indexes all the symbols for you, assuming you have a nice C tags configuration set up. In this case, I do. And as you can see, I've defined different regexes for all of my different symbols. For example, I got one for functions, variables, types, constants. And now what I can do, which is really nice, is let's go to the Go equivalent of what I programmed in Python. Let's say I want to jump to the meter definition. If I do a TJ, it'll show me all the places that meter constant might have been defined. And I can go right there. If there's only one of them, it'll go right there too, without the listing. And the other nice thing is, you know, there's so many built-in configuration support methods that work really well with the tags. For example, one thing I really like is this built-in support with preview windows. So for example, if I open up that feed file with a PTJ, meaning preview tag jump, then I have it loaded in my preview window, and I can use something like PTP or PTN to go back and forth. In this case, there's only one match, so it's not able to go back and forth. But let's say we do the meter one again, right? And I start with one, I can do PTN to go forward and PTP to go backward, and you can close your window with Control WZ, which is super helpful. Moreover, let's say, you know, when you want to figure out where something is called, you realize that's called by something else, it's called by something else, called by something else, you know, turtles all the way down. What you could do is you could use the built-in tags list to navigate back and forth. So let's say I want to do a jump to the F2M function. And then from here, maybe I see the meter word and I want to jump to where that is defined. And specifically, I'm looking at that second one. Well, now it's saved in your tag stack and you can go back with control T and forward with the X command tag or just colon TA. So that's all really, really helpful. And so lesson learned here is try to set up include search if you can. If you can't, or if it's too complicated, see if tags suffice. And once that's done, you pretty much have a nice IDE navigation environment built for you without any need of installing any plugins. And when you have this settled down, then you can figure out, maybe now I would want some, you know, built-in language server support or something to make this even more beefed up, because there are certain things that this does that just doesn't work for me. But I can definitely see where, you know, sometimes a language, it just doesn't mesh too well with Vim, and maybe a plugin works well in those use cases. Anyway, next thing, and this is just showing the tags I set up earlier. Let's add some compiler support. So I kind of alluded to this in the earlier talk I did on how to set this up. I believe I did that for Python, though. We're going to do this one with Go, so maybe it's a bit different. But let me just show you what I have here. If I run a Go build, and because I'm in the current working directory, when I open a vertical split with my terminal window, I'm already in that directory. Again, that's why you need to set the working directory to your project root. Well, you can see I got a syntax error. And so why I open this is, a lot of times your build, edit, compile workflow, right, will involve two windows where you make changes to your file window, and then you come back to the terminal window, run the build, and then pound your fists on the wall because you're so enraged by why you can't figure out this stupid syntax or formatting or build issue, and then you go back and you repeat. Well, unfortunately, Vim can't help with the psychological part of this, but it can make it a tiny bit more convenient. And the way this works is we can define a compiler setting for Vim that is integrated in our file buffers itself. So the way that works is if we go back to my slide really quickly and go to the runtime path, you'll see that one of the components is compiler. And this component sets file type specific or any arbitrary compiler settings you can use such that you can integrate it with Vim's built-in make functionality. So I'll show you how to do this, just going back really quickly to the compiler support. And the way to do this is simple. Let's go to the runtime path again. And this time, let's define a directory called compiler. In this case, I want to override Vim's actual system settings. So I'm going to put this in the compiler folder in the root of my user runtime directory. And I'm going to call this one go.vim. And in go.vim, what I want to do is this. Really simple. I just want to make the compiler set the make program to whatever function call I just showed you on the command line. And in this case, it's just the thing I ran over here, go build dot slash dot dot dot. And then the next thing I want to do is I need to define an error format. So the error format, and let me make this full screen so you can see it. The error format is basically, and the problem with that is I can't see the errors anymore. So let me just quickly copy paste the error here to show you guys what this is. I'm going to show you what this error format is right here. So we can see that there's an error format, right? And why you want to set this error format is because not only can you build natively from the Vim file buffer window, but you can actually incorporate that into your quick fix list so that you can immediately jump to wherever those errors are. So before, your workflow might have been, I'm editing in a window, switch to another window, build it, look at it and be like, where the fuck is that file? Where's that stupid line? Like, let me just, you know, drink more alcohol and put myself to sleep because this is stressing me out too much experience. Instead of doing that, you can just make it and press a button to go to where that error was. That's how magical this is. So all you got to do is define error format and match whatever the error format is for your make file. And typically all you got to do, %e to define that this following part is an error. The file name, you can see the first part's a file name, then a colon, and then a line number, then a column number, and then it's a message of some sort. And that's it. And let's just delete that really quickly. And now let's make this the only window because we don't need the terminal window anymore with Control W O. And let's go back. And before we do that, one other thing you have to do is you have to set this current compiler section or option, because basically what happens is otherwise, after running the user Vim runtime compiler options, unless it sees that this is already set, it will override what you have. So make sure that you also have this. And so now, if we just go back to our Vim file, and ideally, what I did was kind of, you know, inconvenient. What I'd usually do is I'd set my args list to all the Go files, which means I can quickly navigate back and forth instead of going, you know, with a Control O, Control I. Anyway, now what I can do, right, is I can set my compiler to be Go, and I can run make. And that will show me the errors. I type enter to continue, and if I open my quick fix list, all of that is right there for me. And now if I close that, I can run CN and CP to jump directly to where my error is, which is super convenient. Now let's optimize that a tiny bit more. What's annoying was I have to run make. I also have to manually set the compiler because this is not automatically inferred, unlike file type detection and syntax and indentation. You have to manually set this yourself. So what I want to do is I want to add this to my Vim Go file type plugin settings. So let's just go back to our runtime path. Let's go to the after folder and let's create one for Go. And in Go, all we got to do is say we always want, when a file type is Go, to set the compiler to be Go as well. And we want to make this mapping that allows us to get through that whole make cycle a lot faster without that annoying stupid ass screen that makes you want to say shut the fuck up and move on. So we can say to silently run make and then redraw the screen, and that's it. So now if we go back to any of our files, actually, what we can do is we can see that all I have to do is first detect the file and then run space. And that's how fast it was. It already did it. It was that fast. Can you see it? It's so fast you can't see it. Faster than the speed of light. Just kidding, I can fucking see it. It's kind of annoying, but it's much faster than what we had before. And so just like that, you have a fully integrated build tool that you can use for simple IDE-like workflows. Now, obviously, you're probably not using something as simple as Go Build for super large projects. In that case, you'd probably be using something like, you know, Blaze to do all your builds. But this works really well, and you can use any build tool you want because essentially it's just a binary that gets called, right? And a set of error formats that gets parsed. So now, moving on to the next part. That was what I just typed down. Last thing I want to talk about, and I talked about this in depth in the last talk I gave. You can watch that for a more detailed look and how that works. But let's say you want to make your configuration portable. Okay, let's say I'm in a terminal window and I want to port all of the settings I just showed you. Well, what I can do, right, is I can create a directory for all my configurations, which I suggest you do. It's always very helpful, at least for personal configuration files, to have one centralized repository which you use for all your different configurations. So let's make one specifically for Vim. And then I'm going to CD into that. The option dot sign, by the way, is a great way to get that last chunk of text in your last command line output. So I'm going to CD into that. And now I'm just going to copy over everything I had from my .vim home user runtime folder. I'm going to copy that here. And if I go back to the main config directory and I do a tree and I show all the .dot files, you can see I have everything here in a way that whatever is in the vim folder, the corresponding structure relative to the home directory is placed. And this is where I introduce GNU-STO for the second time, because what you can do now is, let's say we don't have any of these files anymore. I'm removing all of that stuff again. I'm removing all of that stuff again because I copied it here into this configs folder. What you can do now, right, is, and again, I don't have anything here now. So what you can do is you can just say sto vim, because what's in my current directory path? Vim with the vim configuration files relative to your home directory. You can run sto vim and watch this. If you look at that vim file in more detail, it's a symlink to your centralized configuration repo. And you can imagine that this is some sort of Git repo, and you just push that and pull from it to synchronize all your different configuration files in a way that's really easy to manage. Now, obviously, if you're working with bigger, you know, production configurations, this is not the right tool to use. You should be using something like Puppet for that. But for user personalization, it's amazing. And with that, we have reached the end of the talk. Please let me know what you think. Let me know what kind of settings you're using. You know, let me know your favorite part of this talk. Write it in the comments. I really, really, really appreciate it if more people engage with these videos, because I want to grow as an educator and I want to figure out the best way to teach people about all things technology. Now, you can find me on Twitter, Leeren, or on Instagram, Leeren Chang. Please subscribe and like this video, because your support really means a lot to me, especially because I'm broke now that Bitcoin crashed and all my crypto's gone to shit. So please support me, and I look forward to teaching y'all sometime soon. Adios.